The Kiwi Spirit. It's brash, full of adventure, and some might say a little crazy.
A blend of cultures, it's born from generations of rugged individuals who thrive on competition with a soul broad as the horizon. Now, to this remote finger at the end of the earth, come four sportsmen who share these traits.
Unique personalities, these blokes play at full throttle.
Free from all fear, determined to succeed.
Kind of makes you wonder if they aren't from Turangi or Paraparaumu.
So on these bluffs that time forgot, where sheep still roam, four young lads will meet their moment, and each other, on holes called Willow's Walk and Pirate's Plank.
We'll see who summons the spirit to prevail in the Kiwi Challenge.
NBC Sports and the PGA Tour proudly present first round coverage of the 2009 Kiwi Challenge. Glorious New Zealand, one of the most spectacularly beautiful places on earth, is once again host to four of the best under 30 golfers in the world for the second playing of the 36-hole Kiwi Challenge. And while winter is on the way to most parts of the U.S. mainland, here in the southern hemisphere, summer has arrived. New Zealand is comprised of two main islands, the north and the south, with Cape Kidnappers on the North Island, just south of the largest metropolitan area, Auckland. Designed by Tom Doak and opened in 2004, Cape Kidnappers has quickly gained acclaim worldwide as one of the best new courses on the planet. The scenery is breathtaking, and the holes that wind their way through the farmland and out to the sea feature tremendous shot values. One thing is for certain, whichever player captures this second Kiwi Challenge will have earned it. Hi everyone, I'm Mark Rolfing and welcome to the opening round of the Kiwi Challenge. Today, one of golf's most beautiful and greatest tests, famed Cape Kidnappers, awaits four of the best young players in the world. Defending champion Hunter Mahan, Anthony Kim, Sean O'Hare, and Camilo Bajegas. And Gary Koch, while you and I have been able to really enjoy our time here in New Zealand, for these four players, this is definitely not a vacation.
No, I would agree with you, Mark. I think these players view this Kiwi Challenge as a real opportunity. I mean, we're talking about four highly successful players, but the bottom line is only one. Sean O'Hare has won in 2009. That was way back in May at the tour stop in Charlotte. So a win here for any of these players could, I think, serve as a springboard for a strong start to the 2010 PGA Tour season. And also remember that old adage on the tour that winning kind of breeds winning. The more you do it, the easier it becomes. Just ask a guy by the name of Tiger Woods about that. The other thing that gets their attention, Mark, that $1 million for first place. So they're into it.
Well, the first round is already underway. Let's take a look at what's happened thus far. And it didn't take long for defending champion Hunter Mahan to get started. This is his second shot, Gary, at the first.
Plays a beautiful little three-quarter nine-iron, 128 yards into the slight breeze, and controls the distance absolutely perfectly.
And then Mahan, who played the final six holes in six under par last year, had this to begin his day.
Well, just a little bit of right-to-left break. He pours that right into the middle of the hole. Would go on to birdie the second hole as well, so off to a quick start.
One of the two first-timers in this Kiwi Challenge, Sean O'Hare for birdie at three.
Long par three, not an easy putt to read. Breaks toward the back of the green. Sean O'Hare reads it perfectly.
And then after pretty much chopping his way around the entire par five fourth, this O'Hare for birdie.
Well, he drove it in the right rough, second shot in the left rough, missed the green with a wedge, but who cares when you make a putt that long?
And another Kiwi Challenge of rookie, Camilo Bajegas, this at fifth, second shot.
117 yards, he hoists a lob wedge straight up in the air, gets it to settle within about 5 feet of the hole.
And Bajegas missed a number of fairly short putts on the front side. This was not one of them here.
Well, that birdie would move him quickly to two under par. He would bogey the par three sixth.
And then some tremendous shot making from Bajegas. This is a perfect example. Second shot at seven.
Yeah, pitching wedge, 113 yards, and this one is absolutely stone dead. And he gets the stroke back, moves back to two under par.
And after birdieing the par 3 third, this Sean O'Hare at the par 3 eighth for a 2. And down it goes for O'Hare. So after 10 holes of this Kiwi Challenge, Bajegas and O'Hare lead. And Hunter Mahan now well short here at the 11th, down below the green.
Well, a blind pitch from underneath this green, can only see the top of the flagstick. It'll start running with the wind pushing and it'll go off the green.
So Mahan, after two shots, not on this par 3 11th yet. And while we have a second, let's take a look at this Cape Kidnappers golf course, one of the best you'll find anywhere. Architect Tom Doak, and opened back in 2004, Gary. It's a beauty.
It is indeed, Mark. Actually, Doak's first design outside of the United States, as he says, you know, not what you would call typical links terrain, but yet the way they maintain the golf course, very firm, very fast, and the design allows you to kind of bounce the ball in on a lot of the holes, really does play like links golf.
This is a great view of what you're talking about right here. If you stand out in this fairway, folks, you know why they call it infinity.
Because you can see forever.
You don't know where the hole actually ends.
No, you really don't.
All right, second shot for Sean O'Hare from the right rough.
And by far the best angle here. O'Hare and Bajegas drove the ball about a foot from each other. And this is where you want to play from.
Yeah, I think you might have just been able to hear Paul Tesori, O'Hare's caddy, say, you know, somewhere toward the front of the green, two putt, and let's get out of here. So look for a defensive play here from O'Hare.
Now, with the wind coming hard from the left, it's hard to get that ball back in there to the hole. Yeah, this hit much higher than I thought it might be. On a pretty good line, though, just right of the hole. Pretty well done.
Roger, on this course map here at Cape Kidnappers, the fairways actually look quite wide, but when the wind's up as it is, they play quite a bit narrower.
Well, certainly when it's firm and fast, as the golf course is now, on this type of golf course, even though the fairways are mostly generous from the tee, it's all about the angles. I mean, you have to get an angle where you can play to the hole, otherwise forced to play defensively and away from it. So it's a brilliant design, certainly from that standpoint, I think.
All right, it is called Al's Ace, and the reason why, one of Julian Roberts' son, Alex, made a hole-in-one here. So, shortest par three on the course, just 122 yards today, and the hole location, very generous, kind of right in the front center, just 13 paces on, and you can see a lot of different ways to get the ball close to the hole. Kind of a sideboard to the right you can use to funnel the ball in, or a backstop behind and to the left.
Well, not only did our tournament director Alex Robertson make a hole-in-one here at 13, but it was the first hole-in-one ever on the 13th here at Cape Kidnappers. A lot of people thought it might have been fixed. I'm not sure how you can fix a hole-in-one.
Not to mention he's the club champion at Shinnecock Hills. Not bad.
We should see some shots close here, shouldn't we, Rod, with this hole location?
Yeah, it's almost straight downwind. I would expect the ball to get close here.
To within 10 feet for his 2.
That's brutal. The only sun's on this cliff.
There are a lot of great holes here at Cape Kidnappers. I believe the short par 4, 14th, will be one of the key holes in deciding the Kiwi Challenge.
Just 348 yards, the hole named Pimple is actually drivable under the right conditions. The tee shot is most important. Get too aggressive and there is great danger to the right. A drive to the left, although seemingly safe, can leave the players with a really difficult second shot.
Last year, both Adam and Anthony drove the ball on the left side of this fairway. They then had to deal with this brutal pot bunker, a firm green that runs away from you, and as you saw, there were two completely different results.
Adam played his shot, and the result was one that is often seen on this hole. A hard bounce over the green into deep rough.
Oh, my.
Double bogey. Then Anthony stepped up and hit the shot of the tournament.
Oh, what a shot. Man, what a shot by AK.
Wow, I don't know how he pulled that off. The 14th hole is definitely a birdie hole. There are several options, one that you really have to think about.
one. Well, as we heard from Steve Williams, short par four, interesting hole, gives the players a lot of options off the tee, a lot of different ways to play it. And we can see here the yardages that are left into the hole. And because of the wind conditions, I think we'll see some guys hit the ball close to the hole with these type yardages and playing into the wind. You can see the hole location. It's back over that little pot bunker. And importantly, there's a little nose coming off that bunker. And you can see how it wants to repel the ball away if the players are not careful. So in my mind, the best play, kind of throw the ball past the hole a little bit into the wind, probably have a chance to spin it back.
Second shot for Sean O'Hare.
Yeah, I think it's perfect right now.
Well, that's the one thing you don't want to do.
95 yards. It's going to come down.
And it's going to funnel right into that pot bunker.
Looks like it might be on the down slope of the pot bunker. So that is not a good shot.
It's
for
just,
Sean O'Hare.
Yeah, it's a mental mistake. I mean, you've got so much room behind this hole.
Especially with the wind helping to push the ball back.
Yeah, the players are playing into a wall of wind there, and I think O'Hare's ball just fluttered a little bit.
Well, there's a good shot by Hunter Mahan. Threw it back 10 or 15 feet behind the hole, and lets it come back.
Jake is now 75 yards.
All right, let's see if we get a little abbreviated follow-through. Yeah, there you go.
That ball kept down.
Yeah.
That should spin back as well.
Beautiful shot. Great technique there. Lesson for the folks at home. When you want to hit a wedge low, you better stop your follow through. You want to finish low. If you want to hit the ball high, when we see Tiger hit a high soft wedge shot, you'll always see his arms go way up in the air to a very high finish. It's pretty elementary, but just remember it. You want to hit it low, finish low.
For the 15th, let's take a look at the virtual hole, Gary. Pirate's Plank.
And there's a reason why, Mark. This is one narrow par five. 650 yards in length. And as you can see, you cannot afford to go left. You don't want to miss right. Fairway slopes slightly from right to left for these players. So ideally, take it up the right-hand side and let the slope kind of take the ball to the left center of the fairway. Here's where the hole really gets interesting to me. Just 23 yards wide if you try to get up into this area. 6 yards to the right of the fairway, you're in the hazard. 5 yards to the left, there's an out-of-bounds fence. And again, another one of these greens that kind of sits right off on the top of the cliff, no definition behind it. Be interesting today, Mark, the hole slightly downwind. Be interesting to see if we have anybody try to go for the green in two. And Roger, this doesn't look like much more than about a 4-iron.
Well, this is 286 to the hole, and again, this ball is going to chase forever. This is a 5-iron.
Got to be careful. The hazard does cut in on the left-hand side very closely up at the green.
Well, this is at the center of the green, it appears.
Look at this shot.
About a little 300-yard 5-iron just through the green, but a good chance.
Well,
or a 4, perhaps a 3 at 15.
Certainly link-style conditions here at Cape Kidnappers.
This is fun. I like watching this stuff.
Well, you have to be creative, don't you, Roger? You have to have great imagination, and you can't just stand up and hit stock shots every time.
And one of the reasons, really,
I'm sorry,
Roger, say it's 279 yards, so he's going to have to carry this ball like, what, 230 yards maybe, or not even that much?
If that. I mean, if you hit the right trajectory, in other words, a going shot with the flighted down, I mean, this ball can run, who knows, forever.
Gave the club a little bit of a twirl.
Yeah, whoa. Look out.
And that ball was motoring through the green, and that is trouble back there.
How far did that ball run?
That ball ran about 80 yards or so, at least. Yep. There is a bunker back there before you get to the hazard. I don't know. It's hard to tell where his ball actually ended up.
Well, watching Anthony yesterday in practice, he looked at that bunker and he said he didn't like heights. He says, if I go in there, I'm not going in after it.
Anthony Kim's ball, excuse me, has found this bunker behind the green, but this is not a particularly good spot either, Roger.
Well, no, it's not. It's a very small bunker and rather deep for its size, but the good news is it's now playing back into the wind. I have not been able to get advantage.
Well, we can see it, Roger, and the problem is it's gone to the back part of the bunker, so he's got to pick the club up very quickly to get it up over some rather longish grass.
That's the problem there. Now he's played it well past the hole. Just a strip of a bunker back there, stopping the ball from going over the cliff. Tough to handle when your ball gets up near the edge.
Nice.
Wow, it's a good stroke
birdie.
There.
Yes, it is. So Sean O'Hare gets to -2 and into a tie with Camilo Bejegas.
We're going past the tee on
all four walk the plank here at 15, and now they'll walk to the 16th. What a hole. Welcome back. This is the 16th tee, the par 5. Previous hole was 650. This one just 500 yards, but Gary, it's going to play about 700 today.
It will indeed. It's called Widow's Walk, and you can see the tee right there in the front of your screen, kind of hanging right off the edge of the cliff. The tee shot being played from that elevated tee, Mark, into the breeze. Hard to keep the ball down and hit it low like you'd ideally like to. You can see here the fairway slopes from left to right. Second shot is played uphill. I don't think we're going to see anybody have a chance to reach this par 5 and 2, even though it's just 500 yards. Hole location today, well, it's kind of in the center of the green. It's back over a little ridge, just some 4 or 5 paces. It'll be interesting to see if we can get somebody hit a good third shot and make a birdie. Man, it is so windy. Our camera guys are having a hard time keeping still. Well, that's going to be okay. That ball barely reached the fairway.
He looked up to follow your ball.
Looks like somebody's hat is gone.
Somebody looked up to follow that ball in the air, and off the hat went. Hunter Mahan finally now. This wind is no longer gusting, Gary. It is steady.
Yeah,
and right into you here.
That one looks like that one's headed to the right.
And if it's weak, it's in trouble.
Well, I think it's okay. We see it.
Well, Bob Dylan once sang, you don't need a weatherman to know which way the wind blows, and you don't right now at Cape Kidnappers. Welcome back. Suffice to say, a lot has happened in the last 2 minutes. In fact, it's taken about 18 hours. You'll remember as the players reached the 16th, the wind picked up tremendously. This was Bejegas' second shot at the par 5 up the hill into the wind. It traveled about 180 yards. Hunter Mahan's tee shot only went 206 down the hill. And as the wind increased, so did the concern by PGA Tour official Mark Dusbabic. He determined that the ball would not come to rest on any of the greens, so he suspended play. They did a little test up on the green, put a ball down. The players all agree. Play was suspended and, in fact, canceled for the day. And now it's a new day. Camilo Bejegas, Sean O'Hare, both at -2, lead Anthony Kim and Hunter Mahan. And the 50-mile-an-hour gusts of yesterday afternoon have given way to beautiful sunny skies, gentle breezes. This the third shot at 16 for Hunter Mahan.
And just a 9-iron up the hill. Hole cut in the pretty much center of the green, about 3 paces over a little ridge. And how about this shot? And you think Hunter Mahan hasn't benefited from this suspension of play. He had totally lost his rhythm toward the end of yesterday's play.
Anthony Kim now his third.
The wedge, see if that'll spin. It does.
Good morning, New Zealand. Players taking advantage of a new day. And finally, Bejegas. missed from just under 100 yards.
Well, sounded like he nipped that pretty well, Mark. I would look for that to really spin back. Here it comes.
Sean O'Hare long left with his third, but three good chances for birdie here at 16.
Yeah, good stroke.
So Bajegas with the outright lead at minus three. Welcome back to the opening round of the Kiwi Challenge. Cape Kidnappers here in Hawke's Bay, New Zealand. Players have already hit their tee shots at 17. Gary, let's look at this hole.
Yeah, it's a beautiful dog leg to the right, par four. Second shot plays considerably uphill. You can see some nice drives. And Bajegas left with 173 yards. Green sits about 30 feet up above the level of the fairway, so players will not see any of the putting surface. And you can see there the hole location in the back part of the green. It's only about three or four paces over that little ridge. So certainly not an easy second shot to get the ball all the way back to the hole.
But certainly a much easier shot than what they would have had yesterday afternoon here.
They might have been hitting three woods in here yesterday afternoon. All right, Bajegas, Raj, good drive.
A good drive, still a little breeze into the face. Well, this looks like it needs to go. I was mishit.
Yeah, big divot. Must have been hit heavy. That's in the front bunker. That's way short.
O'Hare next now from the right rough, 155 up the hill, and both Kim and O'Hare have driven to the right and down into a bit of a valley. So these shots more dramatically uphill than that of Bajegas's, who drove on the left side of the fairway in higher ground. This is 7-iron, and this hanging right of the hole a bit.
Well, gets it up onto the upper level, though, so relatively flat putt from that position. And his bunker shot here at 17, tough bunker shot, uphill lie, hole cut way in the back portion of the green above that ridge, trying to play a low shot to scoot it up the ridge, but that is not going to make it, going to funnel back down to the lower level.
And really, that was a very poor second shot for Bajegas to put himself in that position. Welcome back to the Kiwi Challenge at spectacular Cape Kidnappers on the North Island here in New Zealand. And let's take a look at the finishing hole, Gary.
Well, it is a beauty, Mark. 480-yard par four, and as you can see, uphill all the way. Awkward tee shot. Fairway kind of angles a little bit from right to left, so the players are kind of playing across the fairway. But as we see here, four very good tee shots. Sean O'Hare a little shorter off the tee than the other three, but he'll actually have a very good angle into this green that sits down in a bowl, and in fact, it's what I would call a punch bowl. A lot of ways to get the ball close to the hole. You can bring it in from the right. You can utilize the slope from the left. So won't be surprised if we see some good second shots here.
And Sean O'Hare first to play.
207 left of the hole, and by positioning his tee shot on the right-hand side, actually gets a peek of the green. A couple of the other players really aren't going to have any view of the green. That was a good-looking shot.
Yeah, that's a beauty. So O'Hare with a chance for a three here. The virtual hole, Gary, actually showed you a better look at the change in elevation here. It's quite severe short of that green.
Yes, it is. Yeah, there's a very big dip right in front of the green. Mahan's third, and that is a beauty. I like the way he played that shot, Mark. Kind of a little lower shot to let the ball release up the slope. That was good technique. Want to play that shot with a little square club face and a little swing that goes a little bit more around than you normally would on a normal bunker shot, where you play with the face open and the swing much more up and down.
Well, there's the left part.
And here it comes back to the right.
And just as it got to the cup, yes.
So Bajegas will tap that in for par at the home hole. in an opening round of 69, 2 under par in this Kiwi Challenge. Good solid start. Lots of hearty New Zealand golf fans out here early this morning for the completion of this opening round. Second round will be played almost immediately upon completion of this one.
Should go.
It does. 68 for Sean O'Hare. Nice opening round. He will take the lead. And here is the leaderboard after the opening round of the Kiwi Challenge. Sean O'Hare with a round of 68 has a one-shot lead over Camilla Bajegas. Anthony Kim in with a 71. Hunter Mahan trails. Let's go down to Roger Maltby.
Sean, congratulations, 3 under par opening round. Really tough conditions. Can you tell us what it was like out there when they called play yesterday?
Yeah, it was pretty nasty. You know, it was tough on the front nine for us, and then it really started kind of picking up around 11, 12. And then on 15, I believe it was 15 green, the balls on the green were kind of almost, you know, kind of jittering a little bit. So I kept backing off my putt, just, you know, didn't want it to move. And then on 16, all of a sudden, we got this huge rush of cold air coming in, and it felt like at one point it was almost sleeting. So it was pretty crazy. Camille and I were out here and with Hunter hitting some balls after they postponed the round, and we're hitting some balls up against the wind. And Camille got a 5-wood to actually go behind him. He hit it so high the wind blew it behind him. So it was pretty wicked.
Now, assuming that the weather conditions stay as they are, what would you expect round two will require to get this thing done?
You know, I think a few under par. I mean, I would say somewhere around between 5, 6, 7 under par, somewhere around there. I definitely see a low round on the second round if the wind stays like this. I mean, it's out there. The par fives are obviously very birdieable, and there's some short par fours, and even on some of the longer holes, you know, you can make a couple putts and go from there. So, you know, somebody can shoot a 6 or 7 under par round on the second round. So, you know, I don't know what it's going to take, but I think the conditions of the course are phenomenal, and today's a beautiful day. So hopefully it stays like this so we can go low.
Thanks for your time and best of luck.
Thank you.
Mark.
Well, tomorrow's final round of the Kiwi Challenge promises to be an exciting one. You'll be able to catch it right here on NBC Sports at 4 o'clock Eastern Time. Defending champion Hunter Mahan trails the field, but it's Sean O'Hare with 25 putts who leads the way. So for Gary Koch and Roger Maltby, I'm Mark Rolfing. So long from New Zealand.